Director Mr. Prashant Nagare and our CFO Mr. Sumesh Gandhi. I'm pleased to inform you that the company has been recognized as India's best workplaces in biotechnology and pharmaceuticals by Great Places to Work. Also, it's my pleasure to let you know that Mr. Prashant Nagare, our Managing Director, has been felicitated with the award for India's best leaders in times of crisis for 2021. In addition to that, our HR Leader Award for commitment of great places, creating great places to work and commitment to being a great places to work by Great Places to Work India, we also received in the year 2021. Let me now ask Mr. Nagare to give the operational highlights, followed by Mr. Gandhi to give the financial highlights. Thank you so much.
This is Prashant Nagare. Thank you, Satish. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the company's earning call for quarter one, financial year 22. First of all, it is a privilege for us to be recognized by the Great Place to Work with the prestigious award that were mentioned by Satish. Let me give you some key highlights for this quarter. We have completed the capacity expansion in the Dahej plant, which will increase our capacity on human nutrition by around 20%. I am happy to state that the company had a healthy financial performance in Q1 as compared to the last quarter and the same quarter last year. The volumes of human nutrition have grown by around 70% on year-on-year and 13% on quarter-on-quarter basis. However, the volumes of animal nutrition has seen a decline of around 64% year-on-year and 11% quarter-on-quarter basis. We are hopeful that the opening up of the economy around the world, the volumes of animal nutrition should see an increase in the future. Human nutrition has always been the forte, our forte, and we have now seen the revenue ratio of vitamin D3 between human nutrition and animal nutrition move from 47 to 53 in quarter one, financial year 21, to 77 to 23% in quarter one, financial year 22 in favor of human nutrition. Now I request Mr. Sumesh Gandhi, our CFO, to give the financial highlights. Over to you, Sumesh.
Thank you so much, Prashant. Good morning, everyone. I am Sumesh Gandhi over here. I'd like to thank you for joining this call today. Brief financial highlights for the quarter ended 30th June 2021 on a consolidated basis are as follows. The revenue for operations for the quarter was at 110 crores, which was an increase of approximately 16% on a year-on-year basis and 10% on quarter-on-quarter basis. Operating EBITDA reported was 26 crores, which was an increase of about 10% on a year-on-year basis and more than 100% increase on a quarter-on-quarter basis. Operating EBITDA margin stood at 23.45% for the quarter FY22. Next, net profit after tax reported was about 11 crores, which was a decrease of 17% on a year-on-year basis, but an increase of 53% on quarter-on-quarter basis. The PAT margin stood at 0.31%. Having said that, it is important to note that the benefits of Section 10AA under the Income Tax Act for the SEZ unit ceases to exist for FY22. And hence, the difference between the normal tax and the MAT shall be utilized from the accumulated MAT credit and would be shown as additional charge to the deferred tax asset. Consequently, the tax charge and the PAT in this quarter is not comparable to that of the previous quarters. Thank you, everybody. And with this, we can now open the floor to the question and answer session.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. If you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad and wait for your turn to ask the question. If you would like to withdraw your request, you may do so by pressing star and one again. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. first question comes from Shashikant from Pronta Strategy. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello. Yeah,
Yes, good morning, hear you.
Prashant and team. Thank you very much for having this call for investors. Really helpful to understand. So, could you give some perspective on the animal feed vitamin D business that continues to kind of be weak, and when and how do you think a turnaround would be visible in your opinion? And a second question goes back to your July investor presentation where you did have some price trends on you know, vitamin D ingredient for animal feed. And it shows a kind of 2017-18 big uptick in prices, and then you know, collapse in 2019 even before COVID. So maybe if you can give some historical trend on how these things work and how we can understand as investors. Thanks.
Sure. Prashant, I'll take this question.
Please.
Thank you, Shashikant. I think I will answer the second question first. As far as the price fluctuations that you see in vitamin D3 animal feed grade, you must be seeing our investor presentations, which we release every quarter, where we have a sheet which shows the price trend since 2012.
Right.
The fluctuation has normally been between about $30 to even as low as $6.
Right.
Until 2017 was an exceptional year. I mean, second half of 2017, which continued until even 2019 as well, or maybe even the first quarter of 2020 as well.
Right.
One of the main reasons we understood at that time was China was going through massive closures of industries because of the environmental issues. It just didn't happen in vitamin D3 alone. You must have noticed in a lot of other APIs as well. That was the period where factories were being shifted, factories were being shut down. That was a large reason. However, if you notice the trend after that, over the last, let's say, five, six quarters, the pandemic has severely impacted the offtake and the consumption. One thing is obvious so far is that the lows have changed. Hopefully, we will not see the lows of what we have seen in the previous before 2017. The lows have changed. We expect the fluctuation to be there. Animal feed business is commoditized. Majority of the animal feed business, for example, Fermenta might be enjoying at the most about 5% share in the global animal feed market. China dominates this space. We don't have any control on that. And we have seen these fluctuations mainly being driven from China, either because of factory closures or new players coming in. It yo-yos based on that. We don't have any control over that. Over the last 7 to 8 quarters, there has been, apart from the pandemic, which severely impacted the consumption itself of the meat industry and the animal market as a whole, there has been a severe swine flu attack on the pig population, which constitutes a large customer base especially for Chinese produced material, because most of the market is in China. That also impacted the consumption and thereby the availability of the material. The African swine flu is slowly getting over with, and hopefully the pandemic, unfortunately the third and fourth waves that we are seeing across the globe in other countries is not really helping much. But we are hopeful that the volumes will pick up to what it was earlier. And the price fluctuation will be there, but hopefully we will not see the same lows that we have seen prior to 2017. We have we feel that we are quite insulated from two things. One is, of course, we feel we are competitive enough in terms of playing both the low end, especially the low prices, because of the backward integration, as well as our technical efficiencies that we have on the production of vitamin D3, which we have experienced of several decades. In addition to that, we have a very, very healthy market share on the human side as well, which should be close to 25% or above the global market share. So combination of this will give us strength to play both the cycles. We have enough infrastructure to produce and maintain our market share, maybe even grow a little and sustain the cycles. So whether the prices will go up next quarter or not, absolutely difficult to answer, Mr. Shashikant.
Sure. No, that's really helpful. Thanks. So maybe just a follow-up question on that would be, there is no structural hit to animal feed vitamin demand. It is more cyclical. Factors that have all come together, be it swine flu or COVID-related impact and eating out and the so-called HoReCa demand that's being hit globally. As they come back,
I think
the animal feed demand should
normally
come back,
normal
will be a reasonable.
What I would like to answer on that is that, as I said, prices is something which we fail to understand how the prices fluctuate and what drives the Chinese to fluctuate the prices so much.
Yeah, so
as far as volumes are concerned, unfortunately, except for the last, as I said, 6-7 quarters, volumes had been consistent. As in, when we could increase our volumes on the animal feed side, we were able to utilize our capacities. As I said, we are just 5% of that. Unfortunately, the last 6-7 quarters, the volumes have been also impacted because of the pandemic and this African swine flu. It should come back over the next, I don't know, again, it depends on the pandemic, how strong it is and how long it lasts. But it should come back soon. The animal, the meat consumption is not going down in the world. It has to, population is increasing.
So
the volumes have to come back. Sorry, Prashant.
Yeah, Satish, I'll just add one kind of piece of information for Shashi. And this, you are right, Shashi, and in mentioning that structurally in animal health, okay, in terms of the business animal health, there is no change. Okay, the number of people who are alive on this planet remains pretty much the same. Okay, so there is no structural change. These are cyclical things, the reactions, the restaurant closures and all, the entire commercial market getting impacted, but it will shift. So I think the nature in the animal shape is also redefining itself. So we anticipate that there is no disruption to that and it should normalize sooner than later.
Understood. Great. No, that's really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Next question comes from Sunil Jain from Nirmal Bang Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much for this opportunity and congratulations for good numbers. Sir, I got 2-3 questions. First is, what is the current capacity utilization, excluding whatever the expansion which we have done, what is the current capacity utilization? And second is related to that is now we have increased the capacity by 20%. So when you expect that to get utilized?
Current capacity utilization on the human side, Sunil, is close to 100%. That gives us confidence that this 20% should get utilized. And the 20% we are doing is mainly on, again, the human side.
Okay.
Should get utilized within the current financial year, hopefully.
Okay.
I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, yeah. So animal capacity utilization, what I understand that that is separate from it or it's fungible?
Up to a certain stage, it's fungible.
Okay.
So the drop in demand on the animal volumes has definitely helped us divert that much of the intermediate to the crystal side.
Yeah.
But yes, we still do have... enough capacities at that level to satisfy our animal side requirements to maintain our market share.
Okay. So, if suppose there is a good demand come up for animal side, so you don't have to divert your human D3 to that area. You can have a separate that arrangement.
Yes, unless and until it is much more than our market share that we are getting that opportunity. So, always what it will be is depending on the prices.
Yeah.
That is one factor we will look at when we allocate between these two divisions. And number two, of course, normally the human side has a higher weightage because these are... It's a long-term, more sustainable business, and customers are not the same. These are pharma companies mostly and food companies, which because of the regulatory requirements, normally will stay rather than just keep jumping up and down between suppliers. So human side normally has higher weightage, but of course, prices will also play an important role in our decision where we divert the material.
Mm-hmm. And in the human side, what could be the growth in FY21? Means pure human side, excluding any.
On the volumes, one second.
Yeah.
I'm just letting you know.
Umesh, can you just quickly?
Q1 volumes, you want year on year? Year on year has been about 70%.
You had already said, no? 70% something.
70% year on year, we have seen the growth in volumes on vitamin D3.
Yeah, that is Q1. But FY21, if I can get some feeling.
FY21 was close to about 70%. I think about 60 odd was based on volumes, maybe just below 70. Between 60 and 70 was because I don't have the numbers in front of me. Between 60 and 70% was on the volume. I think total 70 was put together, volume and price combination.
So whatever the extra growth we got in FY21, part of that could be because of COVID. So how you see growth in human side from here, with the yearly growth, how much we can see?
I'll request Prashant to address this question.
Yeah. So I think because I have the numbers in front of me, so Satish is absolutely correct in mentioning that you wanted to know over the last year what was the growth. It is close to 70%. Okay, 69.8 is the exact figure. So growth on volumes was about 70%. Now, yes, it was mainly driven by COVID, but not only COVID per se, because we all the years we have been continuously kind of taking measures to kind of do the debottlenecking or invest in incremental capacities. And also we are just additional volumes which could go. And the network is almost, we are present in 300 countries across all the six continents. And we also had geographic expansion, customer expansion.
in addition COVID. Okay, COVID did help. What we feel is, even if the COVID will kind of fluctuate between an epidemic and pandemic, and COVID is nowhere going to go away in a short term, that is what is our understanding. But what it has done is the lot of research that has happened on vitamin D3 has changed fundamentally the consumer behavior. People know that it is extremely essential not only to follow the SMS, but also improve the immunity. Vitamin D3 plays an important role in improving the immunity. So I think we expect that it should remain in double digits. It obviously cannot, 70% year on year is not sustainable number. But we feel that it will be a strong number in double digits. Okay, that is what we internally feel. And I think we are seeing that scene continue this current year. Okay, so that's my answer on that. I hope Sunil has answered your question.
Yeah, yeah, great, great. Thank you very much. And the last to animal D3, so you had given indications of Q1 prices. So how it is behaving in current quarter? It's a similar level or it has shown some improvement?
There is not much change.
The prices on human side are usually stable. I mean, they formed up and then they stayed there.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, fine. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sunil.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Next question comes from Keshav Kumar from Rexan Investors. Please.
Hey, sir. Thanks a lot for taking my question. Sir, are the human vitamin D prices structurally much more stable compared to animal?
Yes, the answer is yes.
And so what are the current prices?
Our current declared prices in India are close to about 2 lakhs per kilo.
Okay, all right, sir. So, second question is pertaining to the CAPEX. If I see the balance sheet, then there's a sizable increase even in the property, plant and equipment and even in CWIP. So, sir, what exactly is it apart from the 20% capacity expansion for human vitamin D? What all are, apart from that, we are doing?
Sumesh,
can I take this question? Thank you so much, Satish. So, Keshav, what we see in the property, plant and equipment, this which has come in because of the backward integration which we did which we completed in FY21. So in FY21, we saw a substantial increase coming in, which was close to 60-65 crores where we had invested into it. What we see in CWIP, around about 35 crores out of it is with relation to the capacity expansion which we talked about it and which got capitalized in the first quarter of FY22.
Okay, so backward integration would be for cholesterol, right?
Yes, correct. Absolutely right.
Okay, and are we completely decoupled from China after this?
Can I take this question?
Yeah. Sure, Prashant, please.
Yeah. So, Keshavji, we have the policy that we have had for the last 10 years. The world now has the policy that you should decouple from China, which is post-pandemic. But I think the company we built is in the last 10 years, we were never ever dependent on China for any of our starting materials. Neither we sell into China. So that way we are completely out of China in a complete supply chain perspective. So we are not dependent on China ever in the last decade.
Okay, all right, sir. So, in the animal feed prices, as you mentioned, that during around the time 2017, 2018, where China was coming up with their environmental norms and every industry was seeing commodity price hikes. So, animal feed prices, it sort of indicates that China is sort of dictates that market. But how is the human vitamin D market structured? Because we have a sizable market share of 20% globally. So are we, do we dictate the prices? Are we the price takers? Or how is the global market structured? Could you sort of shed some light on it, sir, please?
On the human side, Mr. Keshav, you must be aware there is another European company which is into vitamin D3. There is only one company other than China and one Fermenta in India. There is one European company which manufactures and sells vitamin D3. They have a large, maybe even a 35% or higher market share on the human side. They are fully integrated, not just fully integrated in the terms that a basket of vitamins. So they have value-added business where they might sell, of course, vitamin D3 on its own, but they have a large portion of their business, vitamin D3 business, where they mix it with other vitamins and sell the whole basket, their entire portfolio. So they are at a certain price range, which is a premium to not only China but also to ours. We are at a lower bracket than them, but we feel that we are in a higher bracket than China. Sometimes we compete with the European company depending on what kind of customer it is and what kind of regulatory pathway we need to follow, especially if it is US, if it's a pharma company, if it's Europe, if it's a pharma company, then we are more competing with the European company. If it is a little less regulated market and all that, we might end up competing with the Chinese.
Okay, so sir, am I right to assume that the animal vitamin D would be more commoditized because it will have less stringent regulations, and this human vitamin D3 would be more specialized and more so the regulatory hurdles would be
one of the reasons, and also the volumes, if you see between animal and human, is most probably a 20-80 split, 20 towards the human requirement and 80 towards the animal requirement. This is typical of most vitamins. It's a little more niche. And with such large volumes, and if you can just imagine the price fluctuation between a $6, what kind of money is there? And on those volumes.
Absolutely. So sir, this 20-80 split, it would be quite an opportunity also for us because of COVID also, and like vitamin D deficiency known to be a global pandemic in itself. So do you foresee say in the next 5 years, a sizable growth coming from the entire market of your human vitamin D compared to the animal?
We do. Over the last 10 years itself, we have seen a tremendous growth in the overall market size of vitamin D3. Based on the research articles, even before COVID, based on the research articles that were coming in terms of use of vitamin D3 for general immunity. You would have started seeing right from chest physicians, earlier it was mostly orthopedicians, but then right from chest physicians to everyone prescribing, even diabetes also prescription, it was going as vitamin D3 was being prescribed. This we have been seeing over the last 10 years. If you see in general, like, for example, Indian population, 90% of us are deficient in vitamin D3. Global population, not less than 70% on a whole if you take. So it has to grow. Now, how quickly it will grow and whether it is 4 years, 5 years, or 6 years, and the percentage it will grow. We are internally, as Prashant has mentioned earlier, confident that it should have a double-digit growth going forward as well for the next few years minimum.
Okay, all right, sir. So can I squeeze in just one quick follow-up?
Sure.
So, sir, I just wanted to understand that when a vitamin D3 fortified product is made, say some supplement bar. So mm-hmm. Does that fall in, it must be falling under human API, human vitamin D?
Yes, you're right.
Would be following stringent regulations as it would, like if you were supplying it.
Not
to,
as a most, see, as far, it depends on where you are. Maybe not as stringent as a pharmaceutical, but definitely stringent enough.
So Satish, I'll just come in. Because Keshavji, it is very important to understand the geography we are discussing here. Okay, in India, the differentiation between pharma and dietary nutritional supplement and food. Okay, this is food. The example you gave, a bar is a food. Okay, so FSSAI, India has all the regulations. So we also now in India are pretty advanced on the regulations. So yes, there will be entry barriers and there will be specific kind of rules by which it is. However, when you go to America, it is US FDA, which has got two departments. One is pharma and the second is dietary supplement and food put together under CFR. So there are different regulations there. So it is again pretty stringent. So it is almost very close to where the pharma is, but not exactly pharma. And it is also auditable. So we as a company are completely qualified to support the food and dietary nutrition supplement in Europe as well as in US. So we have to look at the segment and we have to look at the geography to understand how it is. So in short, if you want to know that it is complicated and it is based on certain approvals, yes, the entire market. Because if you take in food, the infant nutrition, it has got very, very stringent regulations, even higher than probably the farm. So it's regulated. Most of it is regulated. Our company has all the approvals to sell in all geographies in all segments.
Okay, great sir. Thanks a lot, sir. All the best for this quarter and for the year.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. And participants are kindly requested to restrict with two questions in the initial round and may join the queue for further questions. Next question comes from Nikhil Shetty from BP Equities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. So I just wanted clarity on gross margin. Because of 6% contribution from fish oil cholesterol, our margin declined substantially in Q4. But in Q1, we can see similar contribution for the fish oil cholesterol and our margin recovered to the previous level. So what is leading to this improvement, sir?
We started making margins in fish oil, Nikhil. Fish oil, as we last time also mentioned during our call, was our entry point last year, and also development costs also. Our production costs also were higher because of that. So the business has come on stream. So that is not, that it started contributing rather than eating away from the margins.
Okay. So
and in addition, sorry, Nikhil, in addition, we also saw that we had better realizations from the market.
Okay.
So internal as well as external reasons both contributed.
Okay. So can you give us a ballpark number of, the overall margin in the, fish oil cholesterol, whether it is in line with the overall blended margin, higher or lower?
I'll just answer this question. So it is, so Nikhil, it is in line with the overall margin.
Okay, thanks. Question is, we are adding production products in the food fortification side. So how do we see this pie to grow in next 2 to 3 years?
Should I take this call?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, Nikhil, thank you for asking this question, because I think it is very important in light of what is happening in our country. On the 15th of August, from the Red Fort, the Honorable Prime Minister made a very clear indication that all the rice by 2024 would be made available to the entire population, which is a vulnerable population, will be fortified. So similarly, the other fortified staples, which is like, for example, oil as well as milk, FSSAI came out with a complete guidance on them as to how they should be fortified, how much concentration of all the nutrients should be added to them in 2018 as a policy. So I think clearly in India, after 75 years of independence, we nourishment and the nutrient kind of deficit in the vulnerable population is quite significant. It's called as hidden hunger. So the entire focus of the central government now, in line with support to the state, is to improve that nutritional deficit. And we feel that fortification is a very important step in doing that, besides having a very balanced diet. However, the question with the vulnerable population is, where do you get that? So we feel that fortification is going to remain, and we are going to participate in staple fortification. So that's where the entry into the oil fortification and also linked with that is milk will happen. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah, can you give us a number, sir? I mean, how big this can be for Fermenta?
It's just very difficult to put just a number, because I think it is all policy level changes which are happening. What we are doing is getting the capabilities in place and getting a penetration done. For example, in case of oil, already the packaged oil is getting fortified. So we have kind of entered that segment that is more predictable than the others. And the others are all under pipeline of getting implemented. So difficult to state a number currently what we will be there with. But it will be a market where we will participate with not only vitamin D3, but also combination and premixes with the other vitamins. So we remain very optimistic and focused and dedicated to provide the quality suppliers, because we come from pharma. Providing products of value-added nature in this field, which will be of quality ingredients, will be very vital for success of this project, we feel. And that's why Fermenta is committed to this particular initiative. And anyway, just to tell you, the volumes are definitely going to be big, because the fortification is not the people who are sick getting it. It is the general population, it is food. So the quantities there are pretty large. The quantity of fortificants is very small, but overall it is a sizable chunk which is worth pursuing.
That's it from my side. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you, Nikhil.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Next question comes from Shanti Patel from Shanti Patel Investment Advisors. Please go ahead.
Sir, what my question is, during the, for the year 21 and 22, that means on 31st March 22, what will be our approximate return on capital and return on equity, and what will be our profit margin, that is PAT margin? Approximate.
Can I take this?
Yes, please.
Shantiji, I'm sorry, but we do not give any forward-looking statements at any point of time. So it will be very difficult for me to state anything as to what the margins would be as on 31st March 22. However, we still continues to state, and we stick to that over a period of long term, which is 5 years sometime, we are looking at a CAGR growth of 15%. Which is there on the revenue, on the top line, with an EBITDA margin of around 25%.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Next question comes from Madhav Kondapalli from Shastra Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning and congratulations for a good number, sir.
I have
two questions, sir. Question number one is on the Fermenta USA. So I think almost it is 9 months now after acquiring the company. So I would like to listen from you, how do we are progressing there actually? What is our target for the next 1 to 2 years on this?
Do you want me to first put in the financial numbers for this quarter and then take across as to from an understanding point of view as to what it is?
Please.
Yeah. So the acquired company which we had, so in this quarter we had a top line of approximately 9 crores coming out of it, with an EBITDA of around about 76 lakhs of the acquired company. Yeah. So, and majority of it is something which has happened in this quarter. I think so, from a business perspective, Prashant, you want to talk about it?
Yeah. So, Madhavji, the US company and the plan for this company and the reason for acquisition in the future, this was a distributor who used to distribute our animal feed. That is what he was doing for a very long time. We saw that America is one of the largest feed consumption markets in the world, very organized. And we have direct connection with all the end customers through this distributor. That's why we went ahead and invested in this company and the acquisition. Currently, we have already, beginning of this call, spoken about the vitamin D3 feed grade market and the current kind of difficulties that is there because of pandemic. And now America is also in the wave four. And that is continued to impact the entire retail business of the meat, that is restaurants and all, and therefore pressure on the animal feed in the short term. However, our focus has been on this business in a long term, so it cannot be looked at in quarter to quarter basis. So we feel that America will remain to consume meat, will remain a strongest exporter of meat as well, and the animal feed segment therefore will be strong. We have approvals and we have access to all of them now. It's our own company there. And we are growing in our relationship stronger every passing day because of this. The entire new company has been launched to all the customers that we are committed to the American market. That is one. The second part in the American business is, now that we have acquired the company, we also, over the last one and a half years, started focusing on human nutrition also. And human nutrition, because there are largest companies on dietary and nutritional companies like the Walmarts and the Walgreens and the CVS and all, and they have a range of products which they buy on vitamin, because they have soft gelatin capsules which they make in their country and the raw material. So we have started getting qualified. We should be qualified to a large number of customers there, and we feel that as we go forward, the human nutrition, which was almost zero or negligible in the last few years, now it is our own company. We have started investing in that portfolio there, and we have got approvals. We started business also, and this year financials will see a healthy contribution from the human nutrition. Going forward, the American dietary and nutrition market is many, many times bigger than India and slightly larger than the European market. We feel that being present in America gives us the access to that market. And at one point in time, we will also start manufacturing value-added products in USA on contract manufacturing basis. So that's the future outlook of this. I think we are on track. We are very confident with the enthusiasm that we have within the company structure to make sure that these plans go forward. So I think if Fermenta USA is on track as far as the long-term strategic understanding is.
Yeah, I think by the end of this year, it will, the margins will be normalized with our gross margins will be normalized with our Indian operations, sir, or with the company gross margins.
We hope so, sir. We hope so, sir.
Madhav, you should remember that Fermenta USA is not a manufacturing company like we are. It is more a distribution marketing company. So margins you know, vitamin D3, especially on the human side, we enjoy pretty decent margins.
But so ultimately, yes, we'll be supplying the product from here, no? Sir, it should be in line with our with our country margins.
You can't take margins both two places, no, Madhav? You can't expect that you will take margin in India as well as then again you will add up similar types of margins there in your own company before you give outside. It won't work like that.
Together, when we are concerned, it will be in line.
Of course, as a consolidated basis, you will always enjoy the margins that we are currently enjoying. On a consolidated basis, you are absolutely right.
Thank you. Thank you for answering the query. So the second question is on the other nutritional product. So actually, I think we have been working on the almost 1.5-2 years on the other nutrition product. So how do we are actually progressing on that, sir?
We have launched, we mentioned during in our presentations as well, like for example, omega fatty acids, vitamin A, D, A and D for oil fortification, astaxanthin. These are products which have already launched. We are going to manufacture the premixes for which work has already started. So, but it's again in manufacturing, so CapEx is involved in that. That will take time, maybe hopefully in the 12 months, we should have our premix plant also up and ready. That will give a much larger basket.
Are we going to do FRKL, sir? This 45 days kernels also is going to be a part of portfolio? Hello?
Hello? Prashant?
Hello? 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 Hello?
Yeah.
Yes, I'm there
Prashant?
On the line, sir.
Pardon, sir, the question, the line was slightly not good.
Yeah, so I'm saying, sir, this fortified rice kernel is going to be part of our portfolio?
We are evaluating that. But Satish, he's asking, is fortified rice kernel going to be part of our portfolio?
We are working on that. We are looking forward to adding it to our part of our portfolio.
Yeah. So work is on, Mr. Madhavji.
Yeah, please, sir. Go ahead, sir.
No, I said that work is on, Madhavji, on that.
Okay. That's it, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. All the best, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Next, we have a follow-up question from Mr. Sashikant B. from Promptiest Strategy. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for taking my follow-up question, sir. If I take a typical CapEx trajectory at current price point for vitamin D3, if we were to achieve 100 crore revenue, what is the capex, incremental capex that you need to put it to work to achieve a certain amount of turnover? Is it 1:1, 0.5:1? What kind of capex you need for 1 crore of turnover? Good.
It is currently under evaluation, Shashikanji, because it's difficult to mention at this stage. I'll tell you why. Number one, we cannot do any more after what we have done so far over the last year and a half, 2 years. We cannot do any more incremental capacity increase. We are out of space in our plants, existing plants or pieces of land where we are having current infrastructure.
Right.
Whatever we do needs to be a greenfield project. Of course, we have land and environmental permissions already with us. In our SAICA, where we have taken about 10 acres of land or so. Now, we are currently evaluating what all will come there in terms of product baskets. So whether the entire load or how much of the load goes onto the, because it's a greenfield project right from scratch, what load goes on to which project will determine and how many projects will put inside, what is the total capex will put inside, will determine what will be the load that will come on to, for example, D3 part of it. We do intend to expand D3 also there. So whether it is going to be 1:1 or whether it is going to be different from that, we will have to see. The more projects we put in will definitely bring the ratio down. I mean, the basket mix that we put in there.
Got it. But a range, can you say, is it 1:1, assuming a range of products, just to understand how the equation will work out, just to get a sense of ROC?
I think the best guess we can do is based on the current what we have in the existing experience with the let's say the hedge. So right. It should be our 100 crore investment should give you definitely close to 100 or more in terms of revenue.
Okay. Got it. Okay. Great. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Next, we have a follow-up question from Sunil Jain from Nirmal Bang Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question. Sir, my question relates to the last expansion, backward integration we had done. So, can you suggest how much is outside sale in that of cholesterol?
How much is outside?
Outside sale of cholesterol, or it is 100% totally consumed?
We do not sell. Sunil, we have two streams of cholesterol that we have. One is the backward integration we have done, which is based on bulgurs that we purchase and manufacture our own cholesterol. Entire thing is used for captive.
Okay.
We have cholesterol that is being manufactured from fish oil extract. Fish oil, after the omega fatty acids are taken, we take the residue and manufacture cholesterol out of that. That is completely 100% being sold in the aquaculture market currently. So they are two separate streams.
Okay. So the backward integration of fish oil, what we had done, is right currently going
not outside. Fish oil, Wilgris based cholesterol. Backward integration is what we refer to as Wilgris based cholesterol.
Okay. So if I'm correct, then this backward integration will, you said that has a similar margin as compared to the company.
Fish oil cholesterol has similar margins as compared to the company. Backward integration is Wilgris based cholesterol, which definitely reduces the cost of cholesterol as compared to what we used to purchase or what we were purchased from outside vendors as we used to do earlier. So there are two separate things. I think Sunilji, the fish oil cholesterol earlier, what Sumesh was also mentioning, is similar in line with our overall margins, is fish oil cholesterol, which we sell completely outside. Backward integration, we buy Wilgris, manufacture our own cholesterol, for which the last year about 65 crores of capex, what Sumesh has mentioned, we have capitalized. That is completely utilized in-house. Yes, it helps us most importantly in our security and stability to be able to manufacture D3, because it's a niche ingredient. It's not so freely available, and there are very few vendors available for that. Not only that, it gives us security and stability, but also it definitely reduces our cost as compared to what we would have ended up purchasing from vendors, the few vendors that are available. So they're completely two different things.
Yeah. Can you share this revenue from fish oil cholesterol which we sell outside?
I think it's about 8% of our revenues for this quarter.
Yes. Okay. Great, sir. That was looking. Thank you very much.
It's about 8% of revenues for this quarter.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. Ladies and gentlemen, that would be the last question for the day. Now I hand over the floor to the management for closing comments. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Bhakti. Thank you all for participating in this earnings con call. I hope we have been able to answer your questions satisfactorily. If you have any further questions or would like to know more about the company, please reach out to our investor relationship managers at Valorem Advisors. Thank you once again and stay safe.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Aditya Birla Money, this concludes the conference call for today. Thank you for your participation and you may disconnect your lines now. Thank you and have a good day, everyone.
Your conference is no longer being recorded.